But let's we're going to continue our time of worship and coming to the work of God. We read this morning about communing with Him and being part of Him. And even that invitation comes even before the beginning of the world. He invited us, and He completes that work through His sovereignty. And we want to come remind ourselves of that great mystery of that. He works from the beginning of the end, from our even our rebirth into our glorification. So we're going to read in Romans 8. And again, we're going to go into the very rich and deep passage in Romans 8, verse 28 to 30. So we can turn there. Romans 8, 28 to 30. I invite you to stand as we read God's word together. Romans 8, 28. And we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love Him, to those who are called according to His purpose. For those whom He foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son, so that He would be the firstborn among many brethren. And these whom He predestined, He also called. And these whom He called, He also justified. And those whom He justified, He also glorified. I'll read that again. And we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to His purpose. For those whom He foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son, so that He would be the firstborn among many brethren. And these whom He predestined, He also called. And these who He called, He also justified. And these whom He justified, He also glorified. You may be seated.
Let us turn our heart to the Lord for the privilege of listening to His word, but also being under His care and the work of the Holy Spirit to transform us from within as we listen. Lord, we thank You for this wonderful truth that we've been learning for a couple of weeks now from Romans 8, 28, 30. Thank You that we have the secure foundation of salvation, and it is Your work from beginning to end. We just rejoice in You. We pray that we will listen with attentiveness, we listen with openness, and we listen with obedience, so that what work You are doing in us, Lord, will find a ready response in our heart to You, and a commitment to follow You, to honor You, Lord, and to bring You glory. Help us, Lord, as we come to You and to have an encounter with You in Your word. We thank You. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this is the fifth time we go over this wonderful text, because it is in an outline form. It is outlined for us the major doctrine that we have been able to kind of expound and learn together. And so I'll just go through quickly, as you see in your outline, the doctrine that we already set before us. The process of salvation, as we said, start in the heart of God with the purpose that He wants each one of us to be more like Christ, with a higher purpose, and that is for the preeminence of Christ. He wants Christ to be first, to be in everything, that He's going to be lifted up above all things and all creation. And that is the purpose. So He elect to choose some people for salvation and glorify them, so that they can have the capacity to bring glory and honor to Christ and to serve Him forever and ever in eternity. And so that start out with the plan of salvation in the election of God in His heart. And then He predestined the details, the working of it out in the life of each person. And so He bring that about with the call, the effectual call of the Holy Spirit. And as they gather to Him, He justified them based on the work of Christ and on the righteousness that He gives to them. And He keeps them unto glory. And them being us, and today we come to the focus that we are kept for God's glory. We are kept from the beginning to end, and it is a major doctrine for us. So just quickly, you know, we talk about the election, and the election is that that whom God foreknew, he also predestined. So the idea of election is that God chose by his own purpose and in his own counsel to save some, and it is by his grace and his mercy. And he marked them out. He marked those who he will save, and he write them down in the book of life. And those who are written down in the book of life will be saved. And again, it is for us to be saved for the purpose of becoming more like Christ. He said that for those he foreknew, he also predestined to become conformed to the image of his Son, so that he would be the firstborn, the most preeminent among all, many brethren. So the purpose is the glory of Christ and the preeminence of Christ. And whom he predestined, he was also called. And so he gathered us by the effectual call of the Holy Spirit. And we said that it is irresistible grace. When he called, he overcome the resistance of, in our heart, as each one of us. We have refused him, we have set him aside, we have replaced him in our heart, and we none of us seek God, but in his grace he seek us and call us to himself, and the call is irresistible, and the means is has been ordained, and that is the gospel of Christ. And so he called us by grace and by the gospel, and we come to him. And when we come to him, we learn the last time that he justify us. He provide the solution for sin by giving us what he demand. So God give us, God provide for us the righteousness that we don't have, that he demands. The righteousness that has to be perfect, that has to be from God, and only God can give. And when we don't have it, he give it to us freely by grace. And so that's the wonderful good news of salvation, and that is God gave the righteousness that he demands from us, and he gives us freely on the basis of the work of Christ. So it's not by our work, as we learned again last time, and it's given to us by revelation, and that is by the call of the gospel, coming to understand the truth of Christ, and come to embrace the righteousness that is from God, given to us by faith. And so, as we embrace Christ and his truth and his work on the cross, God credit the righteousness of Christ into our account, and we are counted as righteous with perfect righteousness of Christ, perfect righteousness of God, and it is his grace to us. But also we learn of a very important component of justification, and that is the atonement of Christ, the price that he paid, the propitiation that he paid, was the satisfaction, first of all, for the demand of God's justice to satisfy God's wrath, because God has to be just when he justifies sinners, and so the cross of Christ, the atonement of Christ, make it possible for God to forgive sin and to embrace sinners, to bring sinners to himself. Otherwise, God will be unjust, and otherwise forgiveness of sin is not possible. So the propitiation of sin is a very important part of the justification. It is done on our behalf, but it is done for God's glory, and to quote unquote allow him to be God, so that he can effect the election choices that he has made to bring us to himself. So that's the flow of the components of the salvation plan. Those whom he foreknew, he also predestined. And these whom he predestined, he also called. And these whom he called, he also justified. And whom he justified, and now it is the part that we're going to focus on today, he will glorify. So we move to the last piece, and that is we are kept for God's glory. So the point of this key doctrine that we will learn together is that we, those who are saved, are kept for glory. We are kept both for God's glory and for our own glory, but the key word here is being kept. Kept for glory, kept unto heaven. So the doctrine is better known under the name Perseverance of the Saints. It's a perseverance, to persevere meaning to continue in the state that you are without changing, to continue to the end. It's also called Preservation of the Saints, to preserve. So again, with the same concept, that being preserved is to being kept at the state you are in, the state you are in being the state of the saints, the state of being saved, the state of salvation. So perseverance of the saint is a name that is used to summarize the Bible teaching about our eternal security, and that is whom God foreknew, he predestined, and he called, and he justified, and he kept them unto glory, that he also glorified. So the doctrine states that that those whom God has saved can never fall away totally or finally. I mean, they will suffer a setback and they will sin in the course of their life, but they will never completely fall away or deny faith. It answers the question, once a person is saved, can they lose salvation? So it's very important doctrine here, and we will go to the depth of it as God allows us time to do. The answer is no. You will not lose your salvation. You cannot lose your salvation. Once you are saved, you will be kept saved until the end, until you enter into eternity in heaven. So because the name Perseverance of the Saints can cause people with the wrong idea, meaning we persevere, you know, it is our effort to persevere. It is our effort to stay in the faith. Like we said, it's some other term is used, preservation of the saint, meaning God is the one who preserved the faith. God is the one who keep us in the faith. Or the general name, eternal security, meaning when once saved, forever saved. So that probably is the simplest explanation by the saying, once saved, always saved, forever saved. So the Bible teaches that those who are born again will continue trusting Christ forever, and God by his power through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit will keep and preserve and protect the believer in the faith until the end and until forever. So we are saying that God preserves, we persevere because God preserves. And not because we are on our own effort to keep our own faith, but as God preserves, we are living that out in our perseverance. So people are ultimately saved not because of their own effort at preservation or perseverance, but they persevere because of God's grace. We persevere because of God's grace. So God maintains our faith, belief and repentance. To emphasize the concept, the perseverance of the saint depends not upon their own free will, but upon the unchanging nature of God's election, the merit of the work of Christ, and the abiding of the Spirit, and also the seed of the word that is given into us, and so. Overall, it is the nature of grace and what God has done by grace in Christ for us. So in short, we are looking at the very profound doctrine, God saves and he keeps to the end. So we will approach the doctrine this way because in the text we only have, you know, one short phrase, whom he justified, he also glorified. So we will start out with that with the flow in Romans 8, 28 to 30 that we have read many times, and we will look at that, and then we will expand that out and look at direct statements from Scripture concerning this wonderful doctrine, and then we look at from the perspective of major doctrine in Scripture that are directly connected to the doctrine of persevering of the saint. And we will see if there is any contradiction if we say we could lose our salvation, or how to deal with the inconsistency there. And then we also try to answer some objections to the doctrine, and to answer the questions that people commonly have. And then through the whole thing, we want to be able to continue to apply the truth into our life and to make connections into how it's working out in our lives. So it is a very deep truth here, and it's a very significant and very important. So let's look at the text that we have from 28 to 30, as we have read that many times. But what we want to note that the text start out with identifying a group of people here and track that group of people throughout the whole thing. And we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God and to those who are called according to His purpose. So they are identified as those who love God and those who have been called according to His purpose. So we have learned that they are chosen by God, sovereign election. So we start out with a group chosen by God, elected by God. The next step is still about the same group. So those who God foreknew, He also predestined. So the same group chosen are now marked out by God by His predetermined plan. And the purpose of the predestination, as we learn, is to be like Christ and to bring glory to Christ. To lift Christ up as the most preeminent over all things. We are predestined to be conformed to the likeness of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brethren. And so that's the next step. But when we look at the next step again, we see the same group again, and those He predestined. So we see that Paul identified the original group, and he keep the same group moving through the process. Those God foreknew, He predestined, and those He predestined now, and those He predestined is the same as those He foreknew, and the same as those who love God and those who are called according to His purpose. So what happened to those He foreknew and those He predestined? The same group He called. So the Holy Spirit works out the plan into time and to space and circumstances, and for each person of this group that He has foreknew, that He's foreknew and He predestined, and now He called, the Holy Spirit will awaken their faith and give them their life so that they can respond to the gospel of Christ. And next, same group again. We're not adding any more, we're not minus any. It's the same exact group. Those He called, He also justified. So He saved them, He justified them, He forgives them on the basis of the propitiation of Christ and the price that paid at the cross made it possible for God to be just in justifying sinners that He has chosen. And now to the last step, the step that connect to eternity and glory to heaven, is the same group again, right? Plus any more? No. Minus a few? No. The exact same group, because Paul is very careful to track the same thing. He said, those whom He justified, He now glorify. So there's very clear that whoever started from the beginning will be kept all the way to the end. And so that's the perseverance of the saints. They will last to the end. They will persevere until they enter heaven, because God chose them, He saved them, He kept them. And so the text that we have walked through the whole process, and at every stage point to the same group, from election, through predestination, through effectual calling, through justification, and then glorification. It is the same group from the beginning to the end. Nobody is added in the middle, nobody lost at the end. So we can say that whoever is elected gets saved, whoever is saved is kept saved until the end, and that is perfect security of salvation. So it's clear as day. I mean, just from this text itself, there's no possibility of people losing salvation, because it said God is moving from the beginning to the end with the same group, and He kept them through unto glory. And we already noted one time, but let's say it again, that Paul was want to communicate the certainty of this whole process, that that it is as sure as you know it's happened yesterday. And so he put everything in past tense, just to emphasize that this is done, this is completed, this is just as it has happened, even though you know some aspect is still future. All those who are saved will be kept unto glory, guarantee. So that's a big picture. Now I just want to clarify that it's not for those who profess to be saved, but those who have true faith, those who truly elected and truly called, truly justified, and therefore they truly kept into heaven. So perseverance of the saint has to be properly understood. It doesn't mean that those who just merely to have, you know, appear to have faith, like, you know, after they said certain prayer, they walk down the church aisle, they join a church, they get baptized, will be kept by God and will therefore persevere to the end. As we already learned, you cannot count on those external things as evident of conversion. They are helpful, but the reality is within. So there are many people who profess to be believers, but then later on fall away. We'll deal with that question as we come. But perseverance of the saint means that all those who have genuine faith in Christ will be kept by God forever and will persevere to the end. So the so-called Christian, the churchgoers that trust on their own works and goodness and merits for salvation, they later on will be discouraged and decide to leave the faith, or maybe not leaving the faith, but they cling on to the wrong thing, so they're not part of the group that God has chosen from the beginning. Now, the Apostle Paul, the scripture also make very clear that those who actually renounce the faith at the end actually will never have the faith in the beginning. Let me just start with that, just kind of put down the anchor so that we have the thoughts. There are those who appear to have faith and then at the end leave the faith. Scripture give a very definite conclusion on that, and that is in 1 John chapter 2, verse 19, talking about those who left the faith. And he said that they went out from us, but they were not really of us. For if they had been of us, they would have remained with us, but they went out so that it would be shown that they all are not of us. So it's very clear that those who left the faith at the end prove that they never had faith in the beginning. It's not like they had faith and then lost it, but when they left what the so-called confession of faith at the end, finally and totally, they just proved that they never had faith in the beginning. So we will go through the learning of this doctrine with that in mind. That is, it's about genuine faith. It's about life that has been transformed. Because God has called us for a purpose, He predestined, meaning His plan will sure work out, and He predestined for those who He called. And for new and justify that they will become conformed to the image of His Son, there will be transformation of life. So again, we will be answered. The question is, what about those who are Christian or who claim to be Christian, but their life is a mess and continue to be in a mess? Well, that is the answer is that then they're not working out according to the purpose that He predestined, and therefore they're not part of the chosen of God. And so Scripture present a lot of safeguards, but present the truth here that those who are saved will be saved forever. They are kept until the end. Now, it is important for us to keep this in mind and to be encouraged by this doctrine, because it again draws us to grace and prevent us from relying on our own merit and our own works and our own effort to keep faith, because that is futile. It's only by grace. So God will keep His saints, and He will see to it that those who He elected and died for and regenerate will be glorified, will be brought into glory. So I'm going to bring into our study a few texts in scriptures that is directly connected to this doctrine. And we see that they are overwhelmingly numerous in scripture, that they are very clear and direct. And as you look at these direct statements, they form the anchors for this doctrine. And so prepare to flip the pages and to follow through, because if you don't, you probably will just snooze out in about 5 minutes. So there'll be a lot of text today. Now, if you're not able to get there as fast, that's okay. I'll read it for you, but just to note down the references. So we start out with John chapter 6, verse 37 to 40. John chapter 6, verse 37 to 40. And this is what Jesus said. He said, "All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven not to do my will, but to do the will of Him who sent me. And this is the will of Him who sent me, that I shall lose none of all that He has given me, but raise him up on the last day." So here we are told that the Father's will for the Son is that He will lose none of those that were chosen and given to Him. So in order to for an elect to be lost, the Son would have either to disobey the Father, or to be without the ability, or to be impotent in His power to prevent the loss of those given to Him by the Father. And we can say that it would be a sin for the Son to disobey the Father's will, because the Father's will is for Him to lose none that were chosen and given to Him. And if Jesus lacks the power to keep those whom the Father has given to Him, then what confidence do we have in Him that He is able to make good on the other promises that He made for the believers? So the only way a believer could be lost is for the Son of God to sin and to be powerless to keep them. And obviously, that will never happen. So from that direct statement, we have the affirmation for the doctrine. But if you look down to the next reference in John 10, 27 to 29, it's just as clear. Also, Jesus is speaking. He said that, "My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one can snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand." I mean, how much clearer do you need? We notice that it is the nature of the sheep to follow the divine shepherd. So if anyone fails to follow the shepherd, the person is really not his sheep, because his sheep follow him. And sometimes people argue that nothing can take a believer out of the Father's hand, but the believer himself can remove himself out of the fold. But the verse does not say that the believer is holding tight to the Father's hand. It says that the Father is holding tightly to the believer. So it is God that keep us. It's not that we keep in ourselves in God. God is the one that hold us and hold us tight. So he is a good father. He holds tightly in his hand, and we are never able to get loose from his grip and perish, because he promises that we will never perish at all. It's just like, you know, we have a little kid and cross the street with us. They may be holding our hand, but we are holding their hands, and we want to make sure that, you know, they never let loose and get into danger. It's the same thing. It is the Father that holds us in his hand. So it is impossible for him to make the promise that he will never lose, and nobody can snatch the believer out of his hand and then somehow lose it. So it's very straightforward. The Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of the Father's hand. Only one that is greater than God can take the believers out of his hand, and obviously nobody is greater than God. Now, we move quickly through. Let me just jump to Romans 8, chapter 1, and we came to this statement frequently, because it is a summary statement of the work of God in salvation. And he said that, therefore there is now no condemnation for those who are in Jesus. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. So what does it mean when a person is saved but then loses his salvation? It means that he was first justified and then somehow get disqualified or get unjustified. He was first forgiven all his sins and then given the guarantee that there is now no condemnation on him anymore. And then somehow he gets his sin unforgiven, is put it back on his back, and now he finds himself under condemnation again. So if that's the case, if a person actually loses salvation, then Romans 8 is a lie, and the whole scripture is a lie, because it's not true, because he get condemned again. And here the statement is that there's no more condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. So it is impossible to be free of condemnation forever and then be condemned again. And that's just a huge inconsistency. Now we move forward, and we'll get to this text in the near future. But let me just read them for you, and the answer will be pretty straightforward. Chapter 8, verse 32 to 35. Well, let me start at 31. What then shall we say these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him over for us all, how will he not also with him freely give us all things? Who will bring a charge against God's elect? God is the one who justifies. Who is the one who condemns? Christ Jesus is the one who died, yes, rather, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who also intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? So all these questions, the answer is straightforward. Nobody can undo the justification that God gives, because God is the one who justifies. Who's going to undo that? Nobody can condemn those for whom Christ has died to remove the condemnation. He is the one who's intercedes for them and represents them. Nothing and no one can separate us from the saving love of God in Christ. Now we just read more, and I'll just read that, and we'll see it so obvious. But all these things, verse 37, we overwhelmingly conquer through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angel, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created things will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So sometimes it is argued that Satan may be successful in separating believers from God and his love. But, you know, we just read, Satan is a created thing. And the promise is that no created things will be successful in separating us from the love of Christ. Now, if Satan could separate us, a believer, from God and cause him to be unsaved, then Satan would be greater than God, from what we just read in John 10. And that is impossible. It's also argued that even though the believer is safe from adversaries outside of himself, but he can destroy himself. He can remove himself from faith. But it's also, we should be reminded that the believer himself is a created thing. And we just read, there's no created thing that is that can separate us from the love of Christ. So nothing and nobody can separate us from the love of Christ, meaning there's no possibility of those who are loved by God and saved by God can actually be separate from that and end up in hell. It's impossible. Next is a short statement in Romans chapter 11, verse 29. It just said the gift of the gift and calling of God are irrevocable. So after going through a lot of presentation on the sovereignty of God, Paul come to the conclusion that God's gift and His call are irrevocable. So God does not lie and cannot lie, and He cannot change and does not go back on His word. So His gift of grace and His eternal effectual call to salvation is irrevocable. It is fixed. It is unchangeable. So once God declares that you are saved, that you are righteous, He never goes back on His word and changes His mind and says that, oh, I'm just kidding. Actually, I didn't mean what I said. No, it's irrevocable. So very direct statement like that make it impossible for any other conclusion. And there's a lot more, even from our perspective. In Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, Paul is talking to the church here, and he said that he's being confident of one thing, and that is he who began a good work in you will carry it to completion until the day of Christ. So he said that we have the confidence that when God start out the work of salvation in us, He will complete it. He will bring it to completion at the day of Christ, meaning the day of Christ's return, the day of our glory, the day of our glorification. So God is not a God who fails to complete His task that He begins. He is never defeated in anything He set out to do. If He had really begun a good work in us, meaning the election work, the predestination work, the calling work, all the things that He set into motion, He will complete that. And we certainly have confidence, as Paul said that. Now, the same thing is stated again in 2 Timothy verse 1, chapter 1, verse 9. God has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to His own purpose and grace which was given to us in Christ Jesus before time. This is just to make sure that we understand that it is not our work, it is not the based on us. And so He has done the calling, it not depends on us in the beginning, it will not depend on us at the end. We are saved by grace, by God's effectual calling, according to His purpose in Christ Jesus. It's not dependent on us or our works. So the keeping of the faith and the keeping of salvation is not dependent on us or on our works, but it's on God alone. And Paul just dropped down a few verses. He said, that's why I live the way I live. He said, that is why I'm suffering as I am, yet I'm not ashamed. This is in verse 12, 2 Timothy 1, 12. I'm not ashamed because I know whom I have believed, and I am convinced that He is able to guard what I have entrusted to Him for that day. So he said that God is able to keep what we trust in Him. So when we put our faith in God, it's not that us keeping that faith, but He is able to guard and keep what we entrusted to Him until the day of Christ. So it's not up to me and my power. It depends on God, because He is able to guard what I have entrusted in Him until that day. And again, that day is the day of glory, the day of the Lord Jesus Christ. So Paul believes in God, and he gives total commitment to God. And he said, I'm not going to be disappointed that somehow I will lose at the end. How can I lose at the end? Because God is keeping me, and he is able to keep me at the end. So we can see that this truth gives the confidence, and it gives us the reliance on God's grace, and it takes us away from our living by works and trying to keep our faith and keep in grace by our own effort. Again, in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, a very clear statement again in verse 23 and 24. Now, there's multitude of verses like this. We just take sample of them, and they are direct statement concerning this doctrine, and so as you build them up, you have a complete confidence in what the Bible is teaching. Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful, who also will do it. And so the Apostle Paul here placed the basis of the ultimate salvation upon the faithfulness of God. As God's faithfulness began our salvation by calling us, his faithfulness also guarantees the ultimate completion of our salvation. He said that God will do it, and the reason he will do it, meaning he will keep us to the end, will sanctify us sanctify us completely, that he will keep our whole spirit, soul, and body preserved until the day of Christ. It's because he is faithful. God's faithfulness guarantees it. So God's character, God's own person is behind this whole doctrine. He who calls you is faithful, who also will do it. So he will do it. There's no question about that. If we question that, then we question his own faithfulness. The wonderful text in 1 Peter chapter 1 and we can read from verse verse 3 to 9 is a wonderful text, and it's just full of security here. Just let the text inform us of this doctrine. So verse 3, 1 Peter chapter 1. Praise be to the God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Christ Jesus from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed at the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, though you for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. These have come so that your faith of greater worth than gold which perish even though refined by fire, may be proved genuine and may result in praise and glory and honor when the Lord Jesus Christ is revealed. Though you have not seen him, you love him, and even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy, for you are receiving the goal of your faith, the salvation of your souls. So just consider the words and phrases used by Peter here. He has given us a new birth, so you cannot undo a birth into a living hope. You know, if you lose salvation, then it's no longer a living hope; it'd be a dead hope. And into an inheritance that never perish, never spoil, never fade away, but is forever kept in heaven for you. I mean, what else can you say? About the security here, never perish, never spoil, never fade, but forever kept in heaven for you. And so, and so, it's impossible to interject anything but security here. We are shielded by God's power until the coming of Christ, until the coming of the salvation, And it will result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. And he said that you are receiving the goal of your faith, the salvation of your soul. So there is no possibility of losing at the end. Like I said, there's many more, but let me just read you one more here. It's in Jude, verse 24-25. So as we go through the verses, it is clear that it is throughout Scripture. It's by many authors. It's many different contexts, different recipients, different groups, the church and the individual and the disciples. And now Jude is saying here that now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to make you stand in the presence of his glory blameless with great joy, to the only God our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glorified, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now forever. Amen. So he said that God is able to keep us from stumbling. Of course, we will be stumbling. You know, we will fail here and there. We're not perfect even in the process of sanctification. God will keep us from stumbling. And then to make us stand in the presence of his glory, blameless with joy. So he said that at the end, we will be able to stand in his glory, blameless with joy. How can we do that? Because he make us stand, because he will keep us standing. And then he followed that by the praise and honor and glorification to God. That would be impossible if at the end he said, oops, I lost some. I failed to keep those I have elected. So this passage that doesn't say that we have to do our part, you know, we have to keep our part, but it is that God who keep us and is able to keep us from stumbling. So salvation is not dependent on our own ability or our own effort. It is God who keeps a believer from stumbling. It is God who makes him to stand before him justified. And now we refer back and we will answer this question again. It is not that somebody who just claimed to be saved and who said that, you know, I prayed the prayer, I got baptized, I go to church, not necessarily sufficient, but those who have genuine faith and evidence of the transformation of the Holy Spirit that give evidence that what God is doing in their lives will continue to be done until the end. So we have looked at the text in Romans 8, at the immediate context that we have. We look at the whole context of the direct statement from Scripture. Now we want to look at this doctrine, the preservation of the saint, perseverance of the saint, from the consistency with other major doctrines. Because what happened when we say a true believer can lose salvation? It's just not just, you know, an isolated doctrine, an isolated statement that we can just come up with, because it connects to everything else. And as it connects to everything else, we have to be consistent throughout Scripture and to retain the unity of Scripture. So it is wise, and it is a very strong support as we look into other doctrines. So we will do that, and I'll just consider some major doctrine and walk through that with you. That you are falling okay? You good? Nobody falling aside and lost in the middle? So let's look at the question, can a Christian lose his salvation and do so in light of major doctrine? So if the answer is yes, we can lose salvation, then the question is what happened to these doctrines? First doctrine is the sovereignty of God. The first doctrine is the doctrine of the sovereignty of God. So there are many passages that we just consider and also that we have learned from the beginning that prove God's preservation of his people show that he is a sovereign God. It is his sovereign power that protects his people, his sheep. So if we accept the teaching that God is sovereign, God is sovereign, then we must accept the perseverance of the saint or reject God's sovereign grace toward the elect. Because the Bible said that God controls everything. He controls the heart of man. He controls all the circumstances and events that occur in the believer's life. So it is very logical to follow that a believer should be kept in the faith by God's sovereign power and could only fail from the faith if God allows him to fall to fail finally. God is in control. God's in control of everything. So if a person would lose salvation, it is not just, it just happened, you know, that surprised God. He has to allow it. He has to allow it, which scripture already testified that he would not allow it. And so if God is sovereign and would not allow it, then it cannot happen. If it happened, then God is not sovereign. When we say that a man can lose salvation, and God said, well, I don't allow that, then we have a conflict if we say yes. And obviously, you cannot say yes to this. What happened if a believer can lose salvation? It means that the final decision belongs to man and not to God. It means that man is sovereign and not God in the matter of salvation and faith and choice. And it just ain't so, you know, putting it plainly according to scripture. So perseverance of the saints, saved and kept to glory, upholds the sovereignty of God. And so that is very clear. Now, so the second doctrine is the doctrine of election. And we have learned this doctrine previously in our text. And we know that God causes all things together to work for good for those who love God and to those who are called according to his purpose, for those whom he foreknew. And we said that is the word for election, that he made a decision in his heart to choose some. So the doctrine of election does not mean that, you know, somebody sometime gets saved or likely to get saved, or certain people who cooperate with the influence of the Holy Spirit and persevere will be saved. But it is saying that a definite and a fixed number of people who are chosen to eternal life according to the good and pleasure of God will be saved. And it is an election to the end, and that is the election unto salvation. So it is working out God's the whole process that we learned that that whom he elect he will predestine, and those whom he predestine he will call, and those he call he will justify, and those he justify he will glorify. So it's very clear. So what happened if the one who got elected or elected by God in the beginning should lose his faith at the end? It means the elect is lost and no longer an elect, which means election is nullified and no longer election. So it also means that God is no longer God, because apparently he can't do, he cannot finish, he can't pull it off what he decided to do. So he said, I decided to save, but oops, I can't keep him. You know, he decided not to be saved, and so I'm sorry, I can do anything about that. No, that's impossible. What he elected and didn't come through, what he predestined didn't happen, that makes God impotent and a liar. And that is very serious stuff when we level that against God, when we say, you know, you fail. So the objection to the perseverance of the saints destroyed the doctrine of God's election and the doctrine of predestination, and that objection cannot stand, obviously. So as you consider doctrine after doctrine, you will see that the answer is very profound. It has to be yes, that salvation will be to the end, once saved, forever saved, because any other option will totally make the whole scripture collapse. Another doctrine that we refer to when we learn in John chapter 17, and that's what we call the covenant of redemption, meaning what's going on between the members of the Trinity in terms of salvation of man. So related to the doctrine of election and predestination, we see the doctrine of covenant redemption refers to the agreement within the persons in the Trinity before the creation of the universe regarding the salvation of the elect. We learn that the Father, out of his love for the Son, chose a people to give them to the Son for his glory. We established that in our study. And the Son submitted to the Father's plan to offer himself as a propitiation sacrifice for sin, so that the Father is just and able to justify sinners and gather the chosen to himself. And then the Holy Spirit agreed to apply Christ's perfect work for redemption of the elect. So in John 17 and also in Ephesians 1, Christ referred to his people as the gift given to him by the Father. So the idea that the Father has promised the Son the elect as gift renders it impossible the doctrine that true believers can eternally perish. You know, the statement of the Lord himself, my Father who gave them to me, we hear that in John 6, John 10, we hear that in John 17, is the starting point that no giver can make a gift that is not already his to give. So it is impossible that the Father would lose some of the chosen and make his gift to the Son incomplete in all eternity. So within that consideration, we see a gap and hole when we open the possibility that one may lose salvation. But the major doctrine that we need to consider as well, that is the efficacy of Christ's redemptive work, meaning the effectiveness and the value of Christ's redemptive work. And this is huge. The Bible teaches that Christ's redemptive work secures the salvation of his people. So all the biblical terms would describe Christ's atoning death on the cross make it impossible the idea of unsecure and reversible, corruptible redemption. So the word expiation means that all the guilt of and every sin is removed. The term propitiation by blood means that God's just wrath against sin has been permanently taken away, has been satisfied. The word ransom or the word redemption refers to the fact that Christ paid the price in full. Reconciliation means that the enmity between God and the sinner has been removed. And the word justify or justification is just that. The believing sinner is justified. His sin have imputed to Christ on the cross, and Christ's perfect righteousness has been imputed to him. And the union with Christ means that the believer is united with Christ in his life, in his death, in his resurrection. So the believer are not under the law, but under grace, and there is no more any condemnation. So all of that is accomplished by the work of Christ, the redemptive work of Christ. And Jesus declared on the cross, it is finished, it is done. And so the price, so if the price has been paid in full, and if the guilty, the guilt of sin has been removed, and if the person is now clothed with Christ's perfect righteousness, then how can he go to hell? I mean, it's just impossible again, clearly impossible. So you have to undo the cross, you have to disregard the blood, you have to ignore the suffering, you have to forget the imputation of righteousness. In short, you have to gut the whole doctrine of atonement and salvation in order to say that it is not finished, it is not done, that the saved can still be lost. Now, when Christ died on the cross, he said he purchased the church for himself. Act 20, 28, you know, the church of God, which he purchased with his own blood. So the church is Christ's possession. We are his. We've been purchased by his blood. Now, all in a sudden, we belong to somebody else. We don't belong to Christ anymore. So again, whoever succeeds in taking away the elect must be greater than Christ, greater than God. must be able to nullify the power of the blood of Christ. And who would that be in the whole universe? There's none. So the whole doctrine of atonement and justification would be totally undermined and compromised if the believer were not saved at the end. How can God in His grace justify a totally depraved man on behalf of Christ entirely without consideration of that man's merit or contributions, then turn around and condemn him again because he did not measure up? I mean, that makes no sense. So it's impossible. And while we're piling up the evidence after evidence, it is surprising that in the church today, even in our midst, the main teaching is that we could lose our salvation. And that I can never get that. Because if you look at the scripture, there's no possibility to come to that conclusion. We can consider the next doctrine, and that is the work of the Holy Spirit in the believers. So if we study the work of the Holy Spirit in the believers, we will prove that those who are regenerated and indwelled by the Holy Spirit cannot totally fall away and perish. So a biblical understanding of the regeneration leads to the biblical view of perseverance. So number one, we are born by the Holy Spirit, and that is clear. A person is saved, is born again by the Holy Spirit. The Spirit works His miraculous power to bring in spiritual birth. That is true for everyone who is saved on conversion. Let's look into John chapter 3, verse 5 to 8. And this is familiar text, as Jesus answered to Nicodemus. He said, I tell you the truth, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he's born of water and of the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to the Spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, you must be born again. The wind blows where it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it's going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. So when a person believes in Jesus Christ with genuine faith, as opposed to just human profession, he is born again into God's family by the power of the Holy Spirit. So if, as some argue, that he can lose salvation, which then it would mean somehow he has to be unborn. The new birth has to be undone. By whom? Well, the Holy Spirit is not going to undo a spiritual birth. He's not going to remove a child from the family of God. So it can be done. You know, once born again, we live forever. That brings in the focus of the matter of eternal life. You know, the Bible tells us that when we believe in Christ with genuine faith, God gives us eternal life. You know, for God so loved the world that He gave His one and only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish but have eternal life. 1 John 5, it's very clear, but it's good to read these verses again. 1 John 5, 11 to 13. And this is the testimony God has given us, eternal life. And this life is in His Son. He who has the Son has life, and who does not have the Son who does not have life. I write this unto you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. So how do you have eternal life? When you believe in Jesus, you have eternal life. It's not temporary life, it is eternal. So eternal life is given upon conversion, right at the point of the new birth. So how long is eternal life? It's forever, right? It's eternal, it's unending, it's everlasting. That's why it's called eternal. So when a person can be lost again, we are saying that eternal life is not eternal, that it can be pretty short. So what if a person comes back and believe again? So eternal life that was on and then off, and then it will be on again and then off again. So that's pretty ridiculous. It just can't happen. Now, as you can see that the scripture by the Holy Spirit is fighting against our own tendency to doubt this doctrine, and so it's important to see so many different evidence that is piling up in protection of this doctrine. Also, continue on the work of the Holy Spirit. He said that we are sealed by the Holy Spirit when we are saved. So the Bible teaches that the Holy Spirit seals the believers. He takes residence in our body and guarantees our salvation at the, all the way to the end. So to have the indwelling Spirit of God is to possess eternal life. Wonderful text again in First Ephesians chapter 1, verse 12 to 14. And you were included in Christ when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Having believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of his glory. And then chapter 4, verse 30. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, which whom you were sealed for the day of salvation. So if a believer is sealed by the Holy Spirit and guarantee an inheritance, which they cannot lose their salvation, because he is the deposit guaranteeing the completion of that salvation to the end. It is the promise of the Holy Spirit who is a deposit guarantee our inheritance until the redemption of those who are in God's possession. So we are guaranteed the salvation to the end. And also he sealed us until the day of redemption. So the day of redemption is again the day of Christ's return, the day of the redemption of the body, the day when God complete the salvation of both body and soul for us. So salvation, regeneration is once for all act. We cannot be saved at breakfast and lose salvation at noon and then born again in the evening. That's just not the way it is. And so the Holy Spirit work in us guarantee our salvation. It is an eternal work. So when we look at all the doctrines in the Bible, we will see that if we come to a conclusion that one can lose salvation, that at the end we might be lost, then all these doctrines will be damaged, will be compromised if we deny the doctrine of perseverance of the saint. The doctrine of election allows no other conclusion, for the divine and sovereign will of God will bring the elect to final and eternal salvation, and nothing can frustrate the working of God. The union with Christ render the opposing view untenable, because the eternal union cannot be on again and off again. Again, the doctrine of atonement and justification, you know, God save and justify a totally depraved man on behalf of Christ without consideration of his merits. And then how can he just turn around and condemn him because he didn't measure up? So that is impossible. And the merit of Christ will be in question. The idea of eternal life will be meaningless, and the works of the Holy Spirit nullify. And so we ask this question, and the answer is really obvious. Can man undo Christ's complete work? Can he make the gift of eternal life less than everlasting? Can he break the eternal seal of the Holy Spirit and evict him from his indwelling in the heart? So these are objections that cannot find satisfaction if we answer that that man can lose salvation. The only answer, consistent answer throughout the whole scripture, with direct statement, with the text in Romans 8, with all the doctrine in scripture, is that once saved, forever saved. Once saved, forever saved. So we can rest assured that we are secure in Christ's salvation. But let me just bring in quickly the objection and just answer the objection, because actually when you look at the objection, they're not great, because there's no ground for objection. But people bring up two main objections, and number one is that what about those who are Christian and continually live a moral lifestyle, an immoral lifestyle? And then what about those who are Christian but later reject the faith and deny Christ? And it seems we know both of them, or maybe, you know, we can see some evidence of that in our own life. But the problem of these two objections is that the phrase, the definition of who are the Christian. So that the Bible declares that true Christian will not live continually immoral lifestyle. I mean, we will sin, we will fail sometimes, but we will not habitually live in sin. 1 John 3:6, those who are born of God do not sin, do not live in sin. The Bible also declares that those who depart the faith show that he never truly was a Christian, and we read that in 1 John 2:19. So neither objection is valid. Christians do not continually live immoral lifestyle, nor do they reject the faith or deny Christ, because both will prove that they will never redeem. So again, like we said, Christians do sin, and we know that. 1 John said, when we sin, we confess our sin. But the Christian life is not identified by a lifestyle that is a life of sin. We are a new creation. We have the Holy Spirit in us, producing fruit, good fruit in us. The Christian life is a transformed life. So we declare that Christians are forgiven no matter how many times they sin. But at the same time, Christians live a life that show progressively more holiness as they grow closer and closer to Christ. So we should have a serious doubt about a person who claimed to be a believer and yet live a life that say otherwise. That's no fruit or evidence. But a true Christian who falls back into sin still stays saved. But a person who live a life controlled by sin is not a true Christian. So we cannot presume that just because somebody professes to be a Christian, show up in church from time to time, or do certain things, that they are Christian. I mean, in a church like this, we presume, we treat everybody as true Christians, but the evidence of life will show that those who are truly saved will be kept safe. And again, how about those who used to be believers, quote unquote, but now they just totally have nothing to do with the church, nothing to do with Christ. They just live life as an unbeliever. Well, let me just read again from 1 John 2:19. They went out from us, but they did not really belong to us. For if they had belonged to us, they would have remained with us. But they are going out to show that none of them belong to us. So if you finally, at the end, deny faith, whatever faith that you have, deny Christ, you prove that by going out, you never had it in the beginning, because true faith never dies. True faith never dies. They may have a religion, they may have a profession of faith, but not possession of real faith, true faith. Real faith never dies. Now, there are a lot of warnings in Scripture, you know, to keep faith, like if you abide in me, or if you stand to the end, you know, the if doesn't presume that you will fail. The if just to say that the reality is that if and or since you stand to the end, you are the one who are saved. So the matter of interpretation can answer all the objections to this doctrine. And I don't have time to go into some detail, but if you take the, you know, any serious objection, even in Hebrew chapter 6, where you know, a lot of people said that is the most serious case, a simple interpretation process will show within the context. The issue is not that one will lose salvation, but the fact that those who reject the truth show that they are the bad soy, and they're not true believers from the beginning. So any objection to the truth, to this doctrine, can be resolved by proper interpretation of Scripture. So we went through the whole process, and we look at our text at hand, we look at direct statement from Scripture, we look at major doctrine in Scripture, we answer to objection to the doctrine, And we come to the conclusion that's already in our text, that for those whom he foreknew, he also predestined. And these whom he predestined, he also called. And these whom he called, he also justified. And these whom he justified, he also glorified. So we are grateful to God's election. We have a peace because of God's predestination. He planned out the details of our life. And we are responsive always to the call of the Holy Spirit, always say yes to him. We love Christ for the work and the price that he paid for justification. And we are sensitive to the Holy Spirit as he seals us for eternal inheritance, but also indwelling us to guide us each and every day. But we must note that only salvation is predestined. Only salvation is guaranteed this way. Not other decisions and not other issues in our life. Those are handled by sanctification, work out in obedience, and we learn the word and we commit to be filled by the Holy Spirit. But how should we respond to this great truth that we have from the beginning to end, from election to predestination to calling, justification, and now glorification? Well, number one, we rest in God's grace, that it does not depend on us. But we also examine what the whole process is about. He tells us what it's about, that he predestined us to become conformed to the image of his Son, so that he would be firstborn among many brethren. So we rejoice in him and we rest in him. We don't rely on our own works. But on the other side, we examine the reality. Number one, are we becoming more and more like Christ? Is our life being transformed into his image and more like him? And how do we know that? Is he the preeminent of our life? Is everything about him? Is our life about him? Just like this morning when we say, "You are my life," is his truth and his person and his presence permeate at every level of our life, every level of decision, every desire that we have, every ambition that we have, everything is about him. Then we know we are in the process of salvation and redemption, justification and glorification. And that we need to examine with joy in God's grace, but also with sensitivity to the reality of God's transformation. So I invite you to do just that, just bow your head, and before we come back to worship, rejoice in him, worship him, but also to do a self-examination in the reality of God's grace, whether Christ is forming in us and becoming more and more preeminent in our life, in everything. And God be praised.